Related to yesterday's presentation, so there was this kind of question about formal analysis of language, and we did system mode, which was answering questions like this, but in Finnish. But the basic idea was that you do all kinds of things, you get kind of logical form, and then you generate SQL queries and this kind of universal query. But one of the clear problems was the coverage of rhetoric, like Persilupli and yesterday mentioned. So machine learning can really help, and that was also actually my personal motivation to move into machine learning, because I was in traditional AI doing the rules by hand and so on. But there were also qualitative problems. There were problems related to ambiguity, impreciseness, contextuality and subjectivity. So I very much liked Josie's kind of personal mentioning these things. And I have to advertise that actually I heard earlier in 1991 where I'm modeling, for example, tall and small and things like that. So that's but that's not as sophisticated. So I acknowledge the current level of formalizing understanding. But one point where I actually challenge also many of the Bayesian models nowadays use is an aspect of the continuity, which I still feel that I somehow feel lacking some of the aspects related to the kind of how contextuality is being understood in a continuum, in a continuous space, referring, for example, that the reinforced theory on conceptual spaces. So, for example, in color naming, compositionality is only partial, so I think it is interesting point that like multicolor grammar was a nice formal attempt to kind of ground or create a theory of semantics, but I think it was severely impaired because of the very strong emphasis on compositionality, which is really only partial. And then about the visual domain, just a little bit lighter example. We have these options here, we have four options, and then we think about what is this visual item here, but when it's in the context, we see that it's really white, even though if we kind of would categorize it without the context, it wouldn't be white, or it's at least the property of that substance which is there. So, intermediate conclusions is that machine learning is really necessary and useful to improve the coverage and related to what Ben Mooney told about the kind of usage-based modeling, so late Wittgenstein, especially late. Early was really not
I'm a late Wittgenstein myself.
Yes, early was not good. So, and one of those experiences I really became concerned about the strong use of semantic theories on traditional symbolic logic. And I rather would think about that really the theory of semantics should be considered to be fully statistical and probabilistic, in the sense that kind of symbolic form of representation as itself is not an appropriate grounding for me, but it really requires something else. And one of the conclusions here is that supervised learning is often used in order to learn something related to language, assuming a theory of language, even if I have it here. So we need to have the language in context, physical and social world, and we don't have annotated corpora. We don't have labels like noun phrase and verb phrase and whatever. They have to emerge from the end. In that sense, the experience that at least I have, even with very shallow data in a way, just the word context, we learn a lot, many things. And that's why I don't like quite the poverty of stimulus argument in the form of Chomsky school. So we are able to learn, so in 1990s we are able to learn emergent categories of works, nouns, inanimate nouns, and etc. etc. And when we take a 15-year leap further, the next thing I mentioned was subjectivity. So we had the problem of contextuality, but subjectivity. So I think that empirically we can't really assume that any of us would have the same interpretational basis for anything that we say or hear. And that's why we actually have to be able to model the kind of conceptual spaces of human beings being different from each other, and this kind of interpretation being only approximate. And then only when the when the kind of mapping is close enough in some high-dimensional space, then we are really getting understanding between the one. And then the understanding is not a property of logic, but it's really property of the kind of more continuous space functions. So next I step to the multimodality aspects, so which takes us towards the movement. So there are some of our colleagues have participated directly quite successfully being third, etc. in some of those. Then we do sign language analysis in our research group and go into the details related to the patterns there. And some of our researchers who are there, they do research on animation and motion capture and so on and so on. But here I go towards the proper topic of this presentation. So many of you may have seen presentation where this kind of connection that they've been taken up, but I re-mention it, that actually for humans and for animals, the reason for that we have to be able to deal with the movement for which we are using to find food, etc. And then there's this extreme example of a kind of animal that transforms itself into a plant and eating its own small brain in the process. But our focus is in human movement, and one of the interesting aspects is that we want to take it quite from the very bottom. We want to think about the continuous movement in such a way that the starting point is not kind of in the categorization, but really to kind of ground that phenomenon. And one of the things with subjectivity is that we don't want to say that a particular kind of movement is walking by definition, or it's running, or it's crawling, or whatever, but that there's a kind of subjective or intersubjective distribution over those patterns of movements. So we have patterns of movements in that naturally continuous space, and then we have patterns of usages of words and expressions over that. And none of those uses of words is taken as a ground truth, but it's more like the distribution that we want to learn about in the end. There has been very interesting work in related to verbs and movement, like David Bailey's thesis on hand movement, and he used petri nets to more formalize, but he used in a very manual way of determining some of those underlying concepts, and we actually want to be more unsupervised or less supervised in the sense, or less manual in the theory formation. But anyway, cognitive linguistics tells us that, for example, walking is something which has multiple dimensions. And then there are people who have, like linguist Ronald Banneker, who has tried to kind of ground in a, at the abstract level already a long time ago. So these kind of words like enter. And the kind of, our aim is to deal with language and movement in such a way that we could, for example, use language to generate animation and movement in such a way, or then we can, for example, ground expressions in different languages using movement as a grounding, so the kind of the single space of finding or kind of detecting movements would be the basis for machine translation. But now I let Oscar to continue.
Thank you. So I'm going to talk about some of our ongoing work on learning relations. So first, many words that we use don't describe object categories like cars or properties of objects like green or soft or whatever, but rather a combination of objects. And so some simple examples of perceptual relations is to follow. For example, if this is my one fist and the other fist follows it, then what can we really say about it when we know that there is that A follows B? Well, we know that if A follows B, then we know that if we know the location of B, then A is also nearby with a very high probability. And we can also note that we don't need to know very much about A to be able to infer this. And another example is containment. So if we have some kind of container, like a bag, for example, we can take any object, and as long as the containment relation holds, we can move the bag wherever we want, and when we open the bag, the thing which is inside is obviously there. We all know this, but yeah. So we have tried to formalize this in such a way that first, the traditional definition of a relation is that a relation is an n-place predicate that is either true or false for some argument. So we have A and B and then relation R either holds or doesn't. And then you have separate rules that allow reasoning. So if you say that you know that A follows B, then it might follow that if we know that in Sierra Nevada B, then it follows that in Sierra Nevada A as well. But this is quite difficult to apply in a perceptual input setting because this is completely discrete. So we have turned this definition slightly on its head and said that the important part is actually the prediction. So if we can predict something from we know, or let's take that from the beginning. So when we know that the relation holds between X and Y, then we can predict something about X from Y that we can't predict from X alone. And we do this exactly symmetrically, so there it is, the definition asymmetrically, but we implement this exactly symmetrically. So we have a learning algorithm for movement data, where we have X and Y which represent different objects. And then we learn relations using a latent variable model that observes the changing correlation structure between the variables. So at each time and each relation, there is a correlation signal RT that tells us how active is the relation at a particular time. And this produces a very fast iterative algorithm. But so far we have only applied it to simulated motion. Now I'll show you an example. So we have these green agents, and they are walking around here in this space where they live. And some of them are hungry and are chasing these cakes. So you can see also the cakes are moving. That doesn't happen very often in the real world, but in the simulation, these cakes have maybe gone bad or something. So we see that this guy is going here towards the corner, and there's no cake here, so he's probably not hungry. But this guy, on the other hand, you see he started out here and then he's turning, and this cake is also moving. He's probably targeting that cake. So our algorithm tries to figure out which pairs of agents are targeting a cake at a particular point in time. And here is a result. So the green is the ground truth. So it's one when the relation is known to be active, and then it's zero otherwise. And the blue one is the estimated RT signal. So we see that it follows quite well. It's quite close to zero, quite noisy, but then it's active only where the relation is actually known. Then this question, I'll skip that in the interest of time. So the point about learning relations is really that it allows us to generalize for completely unseen object pairs. So that if I know that something is following something else, I don't need to know anything about the object categories really, except that maybe they are physical objects. If there's an alien from outer space and it's following me, I can infer that pretty well. And then related to much that has been said in this workshop, that we leave you with this thought that metaphoric relation generalization, which is something that is known to happen in linguistics, where you apply one concept from one domain to another completely different domain, like you can describe time as movement, like time flies or something like that. Maybe that is some kind of automatic discovery of compatible tasks for multitask learning. So that would be taking this relation maybe one step further.
Maybe you can show the previous slide then for the short discussion we may have time for still.
Yeah.